see you on the 65 sooner or later.
You know, there's a myth out there that immigrants do not become engaged in civics until they become assimilated. And what we have found, in fact, is that it's quite to the contrary. If you look at the elected officials in New York, and in New York City particularly, many of our first-time elected officials from the Asian American community are, in fact, immigrants. That includes John Liu, Margaret Chin, who is here this morning, one of our next speakers, Peter Koo, and Jimmy Meng, who was the first Asian American elected to a state legislative body, and now his American-born daughter has stepped into that position as assemblywoman. So it isn't true that it takes a whole generation and assimilation for our communities to become engaged in civics and in politics. So at this time, what I'd like to do is to ask three members of the Asian American community who have worked along those lines of becoming engaged in civics through business and then later on into politics and greater civil and community service. So at this time, I'd like to ask the Honorable Peter Koo to come and take a seat at the table, along with Mr. Michael Chu and Mr. Vishnu Mahadeo. I think I'm going to make it easy on them and ask them a few simple questions and let them just talk about their experiences upon coming to the United States, the kinds of things they saw for themselves in terms of a role that they could play in the community, how what they saw influenced the kinds of things they did, how they leveraged their business acumen and their business activities into civic and political engagement. So I think I'm going to start actually to my left and ask Vishnu to start with that discussion, if I may.
Well, I thank everyone for this opportunity to be here, but most particularly Carol Horn for actually reaching out to the Richmond Hill community. My name is Vishnu Mahadeo, and I'm the president of the Richmond Hill Economic Development Council. But more importantly, Richmond Hill is a community that has suffered the same sort of setbacks that most immigrant community have suffered. We are a new migrant community, and what we have seen here is that our community just like every other community, have some huge setbacks in the areas of education, in the area of healthcare, and that also in the area of political representation. I will not go into that detail right this moment, but just tell a little bit of myself. I migrated in this country in 1981, and I was an aerospace engineer by profession, but I'm now doing community service. What has happened really is that our community has had its own fair share of opportunities missed. But at the same time, we are looking to see how working togetherly in this diaspora of entities, what can be made possible. We have seen that our business community, despite not having any help from the city or the state or federal government, have strived. In fact, so much so that we have a pride in our community that is called Liberty Avenue. And Liberty Avenue represents now a very striving migrant community whose economic success is on the mom and pop business. And they have actually empowered the growth of our community. It became an engine on its own that is empowering our community. From a personal standpoint, I felt that the call out to the community became an issue when, as a businessman that is working in Jamaica Hospital, where I control over 60% of the income of that hospital, but because of the ethnicity of the people that were working with me, the entity find it important to marginalize us and exercise us out of that environment. We became a victim of our own success. And that type of event really make anyone wants to get involved and feel the strength of their community. We were able to do a lot of activities, but very specifically, we felt that addressing the very core issue of voter registration and promoting the need for parents to be more involved in their child's education, we start at a very core value. And we were able to reach and make somewhat of a difference. But what I'll do is that I will just take some time off and let my other speakers go, because I know I was the first guy to speak up here and I don't want to ruin it for the others. So in all fairness, I'll let keep back a little bit so the others can have a shot at it.
Thank you. Next, I'd actually like to go to Councilman Ku. As you know, his district is heavily Democratic. However, Peter Ku was elected as a Republican. And as was mentioned in one of the earlier sessions, he's someone who was out in the community, and he was known by many, many people before I think that the idea of even running for a political office ever came to his mind. I know as a member of the CUNY organization that we saw Peter Ku at our events. We saw him support our students and our university and our colleges. So what I'd like to do is ask Councilman Ku to talk a little bit about his experience coming to the United States, coming to Flushing, how he first got involved. He was very active in the business community as well, and what ultimately made him decide to get involved in politics.
Thank you, Joyce. Well, I came to America in 1971 as a student. And like many of you already know, I have no money. My parents gave me $2,000 in 1971, and they already told me before I leave, this is it, you know, you have to be on your own. So I came and I went to college and I worked myself through college and I became a pharmacist. And in 1983, I moved to Flushing. because I met my wife the prior year, and we get married, and then my wife told me, you had to move to New York, because I was going to school in New Mexico, and I was working down there. She said, New York, we have more relatives here, we have children, it's easier for us. So I listened to her and moved to New York, and we settled in Flushing. And I worked in a hospital, Booth Memorial Hospital. I worked there for between 8 or 9 years. And then in 1991, I have an opportunity to open a store. So I opened my first business on Main Street, across from the library. There's a really good location there. And the previous owner couldn't stay because the rent went double, from $3,000 to $7,000. So he told me, hey, Peter, you know, you want to take over? You're by yourself, you can take, maybe you can do it. But they have three partners, they have too many partners. So they said that's not enough profit to be shared by them. So I took a gamble, I borrowed some money from my relatives, and I took over the business from them. So, and I worked hard, many hours a day, 12, 13, 14 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we have minimal help, you know, just me and maybe two more people, that's it for the whole store. So, but hard work eventually pay off. And in a few years' time, I opened another store across the street on Kisana Boulevard. And then in a few years, I opened another one on 39. That's, I have three stores. The reason I get involved in the community or politics is after I opened three stores, I have a pretty good clientele. I have good business. But a lot of times, anything happened in Flushing, I didn't know about it until I read the paper. And I said, oh, what happened? And then I read the paper and said, oh, they're going to change the traffic direction or they're going to do this. So I was asking myself, no, I'm a pretty successful businessman. How come nobody asked me anything, you know, before they do something, you know? Or the government or the community board, they never call me, the business association, they never call me for my input. So immediately I said to myself, I had to be participating myself. Now I had to get involved myself. So I volunteered myself. I went to the business association in the local and said, I want to be a member. You know? So I became a member of the First and Chinese Business Association, and then I participated in their events when they have government agency come to Flushing, give a talk about something. Well, I volunteer my time and go there, and sometimes I'm the only one there, you know? So, and I'm the only Asian guy there, you know? And so I get involved in the community first by volunteering yourself, because I figure out if I don't do it, nobody asks you, nobody asks for input, so you have to participate. So you volunteer your time, and I take off time to do it. So I became a member, and then a couple of years later, I became the president of the association, because they said, Peter, since you have the time, you want to be involved, and you are financially able. No, so I became the president of the association, and I became a bridge between the city agencies and the local business community. And after that, I joined the community board, and I became a board member of the LaGuardia Community College. And slowly, I joined a bunch of other organizations, the Cancer Society, what else, the community board, I have the Rotary Club, the Lions Club. And I found out the more you get involved, the more information you have, and then I found out by participating, you enrich yourself with a lot of things. And there's one more thing I want to stress is because I'm a pharmacist. In the beginning, I always get involved with the patient. So, but when our involvement is really small, it's usually one to one. I tell the patient how to take the medicine, or sometimes they tell me the side effects. I then, hey, how come you're not doing this? So it's one to one involvement, and I found out there's really limited involvement. So, but if I involve in a community, in a big organization, I have more involvement. I have more influence over there. And later on, When John New decided to this term limited, so I hope the city council seat is open. So I asked myself, maybe I can run for the city council too. No. So that's a gradual improvement. So my advice to all of you is, especially students or immigrants who just come here, no matter what you do, you have to build up your foundation first. You have to have a good health, good education, then you have a good job, then you, because then otherwise everything is just taught. So make sure you have a good health, good education, you get a good foundation. For me, it's easy to start politics because I have a good business. My family is all established. My son, my daughter, I don't have to worry about them. My wife has a good job. So financially, I'm okay. So that's why I can participate, I can take a chance in the elective process.
Thank you. You hear a theme emerging here. We have a pharmacist and we have an engineer, exactly the kind of people we expected to run for politics, right?
Oh,
right?
Yes.
But also you heard both of them talk about wanting a voice based on what it is that they saw happening and that they were left out. Our next speaker, Michael Chu, was actually featured in that little clip that we wanted to show you about a particular organization that has set up patrols after the brutal rape of a young woman. The person that was indicted for that has since been convicted, but it was something that was a terrible shock to the community. And Michael is a businessman. We have somebody who runs a travel agency, and he's the head of an organization, coalition in Flushing. And so I'm going to let him tell you the story about coming to the U.S., coming into the Flushing community, and what he observed and what transpired after that. It's a really amazing story.
Good afternoon, everybody. I came to the United States in 1972 and studied at the University of Hawaii. After completing graduate school, I worked for a Chinese monastery in New York for 4 years. After that, I started my career publishing a Chinese weekly. Almost closed down many times. So then I started a tribal agency business. 24 years ago, I published Asian American Time. This is a free weekly. The reach out of Chinese new immigrants, providing them with information and knowledge that help them to adjust the new environment. In 2003, we saw a need to consolidate our strengths as an immigrant, and so combined force with other Chinese association to form CCAA, Council of Chinese American Associations. CCAA main objective are to strengthen tie and enhance cooperation among the Chinese associations. I was elected to be president of CCAA in 2009. Since then, I found a free legal aid service open to the general public. Because new immigrants frequently encounter many problems in environment totally different from their homeland due to lack of information as well as a cultural and language barrier, they often have little and no access to help. Disadvantaged individuals in the community come to me with a variety of problems. They are mostly outside the police jurisdiction or are too trivial to be taken up by lawyer, are too severe enough to capture the interest of public. Like where people dispute over $500. So I pick up a phone, talk with the employer and employee, try to reach a harmonious stage, find out a reason to explore the right, the duty of both sides, to reach a harmony settlement. Okay. Team up with lawyer and expert, free legal aid service has successfully resolved 100 cases involving wide range of issues, including labor dispute, domestic violence. Last May, Yu Yao, a young female student who had arrived in New York for 2 months from China, was brutally raped and then murdered. in one of the busy streets in downtown Flushing around 9 p.m. The local community became outraged after the news report that several witnesses and bystanders did not seem to help y'all. I could not see either by, with the knowledge that this sort of crime could happen again and more innocent people would get hurt. In order to deter criminal from committing offense, as well as raise people's awareness, I start to build neighborhood watch team with volunteers who share my sense of urgency. 5 days after Yao's murder, four or five members of neighborhood watch team began to patrol the street around Flushing from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. 5 days a week.
Thank you. And, you know, he was able to organize this community patrol when the precinct had tried many, many times and weren't able to do it. When I talked to Michael about what did you think was the formula for success, he said creating a large enough team to feel safe to go out to the community. He understood the needs of the community and that these folks wanted to volunteer and engage in civic activities, but they needed to do it in a way that was safe for them, and he created that. If you go to his office, you'll see people popping in and out asking for his help, such as the employee who didn't get paid by an employer. He picks up the phone and tries to negotiate. These, again, are people that need help because of language. These are people who can't afford lawyers or whom lawyers will not serve because it doesn't pay enough. So just listen to the levels of engagement. Vishnu, I'd like to ask you if you have anything else that you would like to add, because obviously business was for you an opening into the civic participation and political organization.
Yes, I would like to take the opportunity to continue from where I left off, in that we saw in our community the lack of political representation, in that our area, Richmond Hill Ozone Park, has been fractured by gerrymandering. We have been gerrymandered out of the system rather than gerrymandered in. And so everyone there, we are the stepchild. In order for us to really make any headway, who do we complain to? Nobody's going to listen, because the voter participation of our community is not as high as it ought to be. Our voter registration is very high because the folks in the community cannot relate to the political candidates because they're alien to the general community. So we have elected to engage the system in a slightly different way. And that's where we develop the civic entity, and that's the organization we have, that is Richmond Hill Economic Development Council. In that if you take the system on at a civic level and try to engage the social services, the city agencies, then guess what? Things will start happening. We have a couple of examples of our success, and we have actually embarked on this path, and we will continue with it, in that there has been an effort to dunk zone Richmond Hill Ozone Park among other communities, and we kept hearing the word that we are keeping the character of the community the same. Yet they will reduce the front of the footages of the property, the front and the back, so you are boxed in. And now they're trying to bring you down by dunk zoning you from an R5 to an R4, or even worse than that. But what we have been able to do was, by having a civic organization where we get the business community, the property owners, the stakeholders from within the community that can identify with the goal and the purpose of the organization, we were able to attract the folks from the Department of Planning to start listening to what the character of the community ought to look like, as opposed to what maybe what the community board may want it to look like. And that divergence have already started taking place, where now they're engaging us in a very meaningful way. There was another issue where we had the New York City Economic Development Council was trying to propose a closure of Liberty Avenue exit on the Van Wyck. Now, they were talking regarding their needs and assessment they made from the airport and the folks that are coming to the airport, the congestion that they are looking at. But in their factoring of the dynamics of what it will take to make the decision, they forgot to engage the community participation. And we asked of them, are you putting any money aside for the budgeting that you're going to create, the demise of our community that you're going to create by shutting down that critical connection? Of course, the answer was no. But we were able to use that coordination of businesses working together to grab their attention. And we are very happy to say at this point, it's no longer an issue that we have to be that focused about, because now they have something else to keep them busy. We are also looking that when we take this type of civic leadership, and not just civic leadership of having the religious community working along with certain civic, we're talking of giving it some teeth in that we have the business community engage within the organization. And we are able to attract attention from the same folks that are building the casino. Now, we have had all these political representation trying to get a foothold in there. But unless we get this organization, this skill that we are putting together, where we are trying to pull the basic resources of a society, getting people organized within themselves to identify with goals that are coming to that community. So these are some of the things that we are working on. But what is very important, we are also trying to engage the U.S. Census in that, yes, we know that they did not count our community properly and effectively, but at the same time, we have to engage them. And these are some of the civic type of programs, the engagement that we are embarked on. But again, it is not just a political environment and we're focusing just on politics. As our other panelist, Peter Koo, said, that it is through civic engagement you get empowerment. And we are a strong advocate for that type of civic engagement, where we are going to be taken on without necessarily getting what we want in the political map. If we don't get it, we're not going to lay back and die. We are pushing to get a redistricting and get our area identified as one contiguous area. But more so, we are also keeping the pressure by keeping the civic awareness and the civic drive towards getting our issues addressed. In fact, before I step off, we also have an issue with education, because we have two schools in our community, Richmond Hill High School and John Adams, that are currently subject to the JIT report, as a Joint Intervention Team report. And both schools are scheduled for an intervention, and that intervention could be anywhere from a closure to a multiple schools within the school. But we need to engage community and parents into that decision process, because, again, the political leadership is not with us. But we need to address the needs and the issues of our community, and we intend to take this type of approach so that our issues can be addressed. So I will take the opportunity again to give it to my other speakers.
Thank you. But what I'd like to do is ask the panelists if you think that as business leaders, you might in fact be able to get people to listen to you in a way that perhaps religious organizations, parents' organizations, and some of the other civic organizations cannot get politicians to listen. For example, I know that when corporate America talks about education not being strong enough to meet their workforce needs, politicians listen. When business owners come forward and say that they need changes in transportations or building roads, politicians listen. Is that something that you've seen happen? Do you think that business is, or the business perspective is a particularly strong way to get access to representatives and to get them to look at the community needs?
Of course, that's really important, because the business of America is business, you know. So in the local economy, the local business is really critical, but individual owners, they have no power. Yeah. But combined together, a business association, especially a strong business association, they can have a lot of influence over government decisions. So I encourage all the business owners, you by yourself, you have no power. No matter how much money you make in your business, you're just one individual business. But if you join together with other businesses, and if you have a common goal for your district or for anything related to traffic, safety, public safety, and the elected officials will listen to business associations or civic groups. Yeah. So together is really important. Together, unity is really important.
Do either one of you have some more comments?
Oh, yes. Okay. What Peter said is also very, very important, in that we had the experience of having to deal with the Commissioner of Transportation of Queens, and that's to do with the congested corridors within Queens. And Liberty Avenue, again, was one of those congested corridors that was cited. But when you talk through the established civic organization, namely the community boards, you're just seeing a handful of the people who are 10 or 20 years used to be the community leaders that continue to be in those positions, but they're not engaging the community effectively. A civic organization with business acumen added onto it, what it does, you have a more effective way of talking to your community. People listen to you more. And when you call a meeting, you get maybe 100, 150 people turns up to your meeting. Take, for instance, yesterday we had a census reach out to the new American website that they are launching. And we had about a good 40 people that turned up to that meeting at a very short notice. Census on its own would probably get about 10 people. But what is important is that we were able to use a civic engagement and was able to have solutions that the community can relate more to, because it is a community's decision. It is more one-to-one. These are, you know, some of the things that helps, and I'm hoping that within this room here, we have a lot of leadership of many other organizations. There is a lot of energy within the community, and the beauty of the civic engagement, it is not like politics. You run for a while, and if you didn't get through, you drop off the scene. The civic engagement is continuous. It is always there. And if you're not there, there's someone to work along with you. There's another generation that's coming up, nurturing that. So my question really is, the issue that I want to flag really is that getting the business community and the civic organization, you also even get the religious community now paying you more attention, because issues like, as Peter said, if you talk by yourself, nobody listens. But let's say, for instance, a church or a mandir in our community or an ashram, they want to get their buildings, because the census data is saying that our numbers are getting up. But if you go to the Department of Buildings, they're saying, no, the zoning says you need to be at a certain level. But if this entity is serving the needs of a growing community, it has to grow up, not grow down. So we are able to advocate a position where you can get your places of worship or your places where you provide service to the community to get the type of scaling that is necessary to provide the proper service to your community. So there is much merit towards getting community-based organization, civic organization, reaching out to its community, because you get more effective communication that way.
Thank you. If you had one piece of advice to communities about how to organize politically, what do you think that would be?
Okay.
That's a hard question, I know.
First and foremost, one has to be a good cause, not motivate the community. That the member must have a shared sense of need action to carry out for the mission. In my case, to stop crime and safeguarding the community. Our Neighborhood Watch team is one of the most effective and least cost way to prevent crime and reduce fear. Okay. Until today, the size of our group has grown from 4 or 5 people to 600 people, less than a year. 600 volunteers. It's increasing steadily. We have adopted a long-term attitude from the start. We see the watch team as a civic duty and not a vigilant group. Our aim is to prevent crime, to build up bond among the residents and law enforcement, and to establish a base, a net, a kind of social awakened movement for broader community improvement. Also, all members share patrol duty, so the burden will not fall on any particular individual. For example, 1 or 2 patrolling night per month per member.
So what he's done basically is brought people together on a cause that they all care about. And he's made sure that everybody shares the responsibility. I must say that this group goes out in the community and, for example, they run into a woman who's sitting on the steps crying, and apparently she's a victim of domestic violence. They actually bring her to Michael's office, and he tries to contact agencies that can be helpful to her. That's what this group does. They're almost like mom and pops in the community. It's really exciting to see what happens there. Councilman Ku, do you have a specific piece of advice about organizing in the community and organizing towards social change?
My advice is like if you don't get involved, you won't get results. No? So anything, we have to take initiative, we have to be proactive. Anything you see wrong in your community, don't wait for other people to do it. No, you can do it yourself, you can join a civic group like Ming Kwan Center or AFI, because together your voice is much bigger. Since I become a city council member, I always pay attention to groups of people. They come to my office to complain. Now, if you are individual business people, you complain, oh, you just worry about your business. But a group of people, they come to complain about the community things. It's because they want to improve the community, you know, either sanitation or traffic, whatever, but because they're doing it for the community good. So I always pay most important attention to groups of people coming to our office, and we try to resolve the problem for them with different city agencies. So my advice is, you have to get involved. Don't be selfish. If it's only for individual improvement or for your business, that's not the elected officials. They know no. But if you come as a group, as a civic group or business group, we usually try our utmost to solve their problems.
Yeah. Thank you. And Vishnu, your piece of advice.
Yes. In fact, on top of some of the advice I've been throwing out already, what I would like to suggest is that what we are doing in our community has been really to start the process of identifying leadership. Rather than having, as before, where anyone who has some money in his pocket and feel empowered and he will just identify himself as a candidate and run and then lose. we feel that that type of creation creates a sense of loss within a community, and people separate themselves from the political system. What we have embarked on is to take the approach of let the community leaders identify among themselves who was potentially an effective leader. Because the idea behind that is that it is not that candidate that is running anymore, and he has to get his political machinery to go with him. Really, to get now the civic society and the religious community more engaged. Because once they're part of the decision process of identifying who should be the next leader or who should be on that bunch of leadership, then it is easy to call upon that now bigger team to come and assist and to start this process of politically empowering the community. One of the more important things, though, is the engagement of the new generation, or the Y generation, as it seems to be calling themselves. That is a very, very important thing, in that they need to be meaningfully engaged in the leadership of your community. They need to be seen in the front line. They need to actively partake. And it's a conscious way where people that are the more mature leadership in a community needs to step back a little and create that opportunity to mold the next generation. Because if we don't start the planning, because we are here to stay, this is home, we need to start making generational investment. And we need to start that process as early as we can. We need to start identifying those youth leadership, empower them, give them that push, give them that encouragement. So these are some of the things that we have started in our community, and we are hoping that within the next decade, things will turn around for us.
Thank you. That's a perfect segue, because of the fact that what we're talking about is pipeline politics. You know, creating those grassroots movements from things like street patrols to progressively greater involvement through business associations. And then, even though they're new immigrants, they can be extremely effective communities. And then looking on to cultivating the future generations. And so you're seeing before you a panel of very effective newcomers to America. And they clearly have a great vision for how to help their communities and to get that pipeline really flowing with people. And I want to thank them for their time and their insights. Does anyone have any comments about the question that was just asked? I believe what Robert is saying is that as the economy changes, as the political scene changes, everybody's looking forward, fast and forward, but they're not preserving the history and the culture, particularly of people from our communities, for example, who played such a tremendous role as our forefathers. And so he's interested in preserving some of that and making sure that our communities are represented in all the new arts and cultures movements. I know he mentioned an organization that came in to the Chinatown area, and never once did they engage the Chinese community to see how that community could engage and be part of the discussion, the programming, and so forth. It's as if we didn't exist. We're going to bypass you and just move right past you.
I'd like to add to that, in that I'm from Guyana. I'm sixth generation from India. But if you meet, if I had not said that, I'm pretty sure many of you would have thought I'm from India, but I'm sixth generation living there. So I'm a living reality of trying to preserve culture and identity. What we have done through our business organization is to blend the art community with us, because when we have our street fairs, we create murals, get the artists involved in that. We also, when we have our cultural affairs, recently we had the Pagwa Parade on Liberty Avenue, and we were able to get our artists and our culture integrated into our mainstream activity, because our identity is protected, and if we don't understand how integrated it is in our own development, we're going to put the next generation at a disadvantage. So we try on a very day-to-day basis to keep that content of art high and keep it alive.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Well, America is a country of immigrants, you know. And when immigrants come, they bring their culture, they bring their heritage. There's, you know, culture and heritage is really important. We have to make sure we maintain our culture or improve our culture. Let other people know about the culture. And another thing is, I always said, America is a big salad bowl. It's not a melting pot. If it's a big melting pot, we all become one color. No, but after living so many generations, we still our own color. You're black, always black. No, we're Chinese. We always know Chinese. Or Korean, always know Korean. Right. So we all have to be proud of our heritage, maintain our culture, our arts and culture, because individually, we show different things, and we but combined together, we still a harmonious society. We appreciate each other's culture and art. So I'm always in a position to support arts and culture, and I'm and also for the future generations, make sure they are from remember they come that their grandparents or their great parents come from wherever country they come from, and let them be proud of themselves.
Thank you. All right, well, I think that's all the time that we have for this panel. Thank you very much.